Figure, the day after Rosh Hashanah, this is the episode I gotta watch.
The Enterprise is en route to the planet Echoes to find Professor John Gill, a historian who is there as a Federation cultural observer. As they approach the planet, a rocket is fired from Echoes, a planet which is supposed to be primitive and warlike, and this rocket is armed with a nuclear warhead. After destroying it with a phaser, Kirk and Spock decide to beam down. Now, what in the hell are they wearing? I get that this is supposed to be a primitive planet, but I didn't realize that, you know, Levi's denim were considered primitive clothing. Once they beam down, they see a man who seems to be running away from something, and warns our duo to go and hide, and that's when we get a wonderful surprise! Nazis! It seems that the man who is running away is from the planet Zeon in the same star system, and apparently here they are the Untermenschen. Kirk and Spock make the point that the possibility of an alien culture evolving a society identical in every single way to Nazi Germany is almost impossible. And that's when they realize that the Führer is none other than Professor John Gill. When they are found by an SS officer, Kirk gives him the judo chop and... oh, Lord. Poor Leonard Nimoy. You know his Bubby and Zadie are like rolling in their grave right now. So they both get themselves some Nazi uniforms and plan to find John Gill and find out what in the hell is going on. But of course, that's when they're found out. The SS spend a little bit of time beating them until party chairman Enig orders them to be locked up for future questioning. Spock and Kirk go all MacGyver style and use their transponders and a piece of metal to make a crude laser. They grab their communicators and with the help of a Zeon named Isek, make their way to the underground. As they try to formulate a plan, they are discovered by Daras, a ranking member of the party and hero of the Fatherland. And after a brief confrontation, they realize that she's actually an Ecosian who is fighting the Nazi party from the inside. She takes Spock, Kirk, and Isek to a major event at the Führer's headquarters. Apparently, the Führer's planned a final solution to the Zeon homeworld and is announcing it today. Spock gets a glimpse of Gill, and he appears to be catatonic or drugged or something. And Kirk and Spock call up the Enterprise for McCoy to come down and give them some help. McCoy beams down, and they go to see the speech where McCoy observes that Gill appears to be in some sort of drug state. The group gets into the booth, and McCoy manages to bring Gill to a state where he can basically just answer questions. And it's then that he explains that he uses the model of Nazi Germany as a way to unify the Ecosians before they destroyed themselves, hoping to use the effectiveness of a totalitarian regime in a benign sort of way. But Deputy Führer Melikon decided to take control and drugged him, keeping him around as a figurehead. Kirk manages to get Gill to full consciousness long enough to declare that Melikon has usurped power and to end the conflict with Zeon, before ultimately dying. Party Chairman Enig, who it turns out is a member of the Resistance, declares that enough people have died, and now it is time for everyone to live.
So, of course, the most blatant thing we have to talk about is the use of the Nazi Party, Nazi Germany, in this episode. It's interesting because in the episode, Spock does refer to Nazi Germany as being the most effective national power in the history of humanity. Now, that was all big thinking, apparently, in America back in the 1960s. I guess as the fear of Soviet Russia and communism on the rise, a lot of people on the right really looked more to fascism as being the solution to that. And even going back to the era of Nazi Germany, a lot of people who didn't want to get involved in the war in Europe often said that Hitler could be used as a tool to fight Bolshevism and sort of these radical liberal movements in the form of communism and socialism. It's interesting to note that a lot of really what helped Germany rise to power in the 30s were things which were implemented back in the 1920s, before Nazism became even a thing in the political radar of the German people. One of the tactics of people like Gustav Stresemann, who was a chancellor of Germany in the 1920s, was to go and basically give in to the Treaty of Versailles, and give in to some of the things that a lot of Germans didn't really want to do, in order to hopefully convince the French, specifically the French, to allow parts of that treaty to be rescinded that were much harsher on the German populace. It also allowed Germany to enter into League of Nations and become a normal country again in that time period. And those things, even prior to the Great Depression, really set the stage for allowing Hitler to have the huge rise of power. I mean, he wasn't some super genius, some people think that he was. He was really just a man who walked into a situation which was prepared for creating Germany into a great powerhouse, and all he needed was someone to push it along, and he and his cohorts were the ones to do it, unfortunately. Now, interestingly, I do kind of want to ask if anyone who lives in Europe, and specifically Germany watching this, I was reading that up until very recently, I mean like 2011, very recently, this episode was not allowed to be aired in Germany. Now, it did get released, I think, on VHS and DVD at some point, you could get it, but on television in Germany, this episode wasn't aired. And Austria was aired, and for those areas in Germany that could get television signals from Austria, they were able to see this episode. But my understanding from some of the research that I've done is that no one in Germany ever saw this episode until extremely recently. So if anyone knows that's true or not, please let me know in the comments down below, just because I'm very curious to see if that's the case. Overall, I felt like the episode was very good. It's very well acted, very well written. I did like how the writer sort of added in references basically to Jews and the Jewish people. You have a character named Isaac, which is like Isaac. Avram, which is like Abraham. And the character of Dars is basically an allusion to the character of Sarah. And they're all from a planet called Zion, which is just one letter off from being Zion, which is again another reference to the Jewish Bible and Jewish scripture. So it's interesting they sort of slid in a little bit of this being sort of an analogy also for what was going on with the Holocaust and the Final Solution. So I felt that that was very well done. Overall, I'll give the episode 4 out of 5. Again, like I said, it's very well done, well acted, well written. Definitely give it a watch if you haven't seen it yet. So my common question for you guys is, what is your favorite World War II era movie or television series or miniseries or whatever? Definitely, I'd probably have to say my two favorites, Band of Brothers and Saving Private Ryan. Although I am a sucker for alternative history, so I do have to sort of throw in a little movie called Fatherland. If you've never seen it, try and check it out and find it. It was made back in the 80s. The premise, of course, being is that Germany wins the Second World War, aside from still fighting the Russians in the Eastern Front. And it's about taking place in the 60s, where Germany controls all of Europe. And there's Greater Germany, and Hitler's still in control. It's a very interesting watch, and I definitely give it a recommendation. Definitely go check it out. So if you enjoyed this episode, make sure you hit that like button. Make sure you share. Hit Facebook, Twitter, however you do it. If you haven't subscribed yet, you can subscribe right here. If you missed the last episode, annotation's going to be right over here. And next time, we'll be watching by any other name. So we'll see you then in the challenge. Bye, guys.